I've been at MIT for 44 years. I went to TED 1. There's only one other person here, I think, who did that. All the other TEDs, and I went to them all under Ricky's regime, I talked about what the Media Lab was doing, which today has almost 500 people in it. And if you read the press, it actually last week said I quit the Media Lab. I didn't quit the Media Lab. I stepped down as chairman, and which was a kind of ridiculous title. But someone else has taken it on, and one of the things you can do as a professor is you stay on as a professor, and I will now do, for the rest of my life, the one laptop per child, which I've sort of been doing for a year and a half anyway. So I'm going to tell you about this, use my 18 minutes to tell you why doing it, how we're doing it, and then what we're doing. And at some point, I'll even pass around what the $100 laptop might be like. Now, I was asked by Chris to talk about some of the big issues, and so I figured I'd start with the three that at least drove me to do this. And the first is pretty obvious. It's amazing when you meet a head of state and you say, what is your most precious natural resource? They will not say children at first. And then when you say children, they will pretty quickly agree with you. And so that isn't very hard. Everybody agrees that whatever the solutions are to the big problems, they include education, sometimes can be just education, and can never be without some element of education. So that's certainly part of it. And the third is a little bit less obvious, and that is that we all in this room learned how to walk, how to talk, not by being taught how to talk or taught how to walk, but by interacting with the world, by having certain results as a consequence of being able to ask for something or being able to stand up and reach it. Whereas at about the age 6, we were told to stop learning that way and that all learning from then on would happen through teaching, whether it's people standing up like I'm doing now or a book or something, but it was really through teaching. And one of the things in general that computers have provided to learning is that it now includes a kind of learning which is a little bit more like walking and talking, in the sense that a lot of it's driven by the learner himself or herself. So with those as the principles, some of you may know Seymour Papert. This is back in 1982 when we were working in Senegal, because some people think that the $100 laptop just happened a year ago or 2 years ago, or some we were struck by lightning. This actually has gone back a long time, and in fact, back to the 60s. Here we're in the 80s. Steve Jobs had given us some laptops. We were in Senegal. It didn't scale, but it at least was bringing computers to developing countries and learning pretty quickly that these kids, even though English wasn't their language, the Latin alphabet barely was their language, but they could just swim like fish, they could play these like pianos. A little bit more recently, I got involved personally, and sort of these are two anecdotes. One was in Cambodia, in a village that has no electricity, no water, no television, no telephone, but has broadband internet now. And these kids, their first English word is Google, and they only know Skype. They've never heard of telephony, okay? They just use Skype. And they go home at night, they've got a broadband connection in a hut that doesn't have electricity. The parents love it, because when they open up the laptops, it's the brightest light source in the house. And talk about where metaphors and reality mix. This is the actual school. In parallel with this, Seymour Papert got the governor of Maine to legislate one laptop per child in the year 2002. Now, at the time, I think it's fair to say that 80% of the teachers were, let me say, apprehensive. Really, they were actually against it. And they really preferred that the money would be used for higher salaries, more schools, whatever. And now, 3.5 years later, guess what? They're reporting five things. Drop of truancy to almost zero. attending parent-teacher meetings, which nobody did and now almost everybody does, drop in discipline problems, increase in student participation. Teachers are now saying it's kind of fun to teach, kids are engaged, they have laptops. And then the fifth, which interests me the most, is that the servers have to be turned off at certain times at night because the teachers are just getting too much email from the kids asking them for help. So when you see that kind of thing, this is not something you have to test. The days of pilot projects are over. When people say, well, we'd like to do 3,000 or 4,000 in our country to see how it works, screw you. Go to the back of the line and someone else will do it. And then when you figure out that this works, you can join as well. And this is so what we're doing. So One Laptop Per Child was formed about a year and a half ago. It's a nonprofit association that raised about $20 million to do the engineering to just get this built and then have it produced afterwards. Scale is truly important, and it's not important because you can buy components at a lower price, okay? It's because you can go to a manufacturer, and I will leave the name out, but we wanted, you know, a small display, doesn't have to have perfect color uniformity, can even have a pixel or two missing. It doesn't have to be that bright. And this particular manufacturer said, well, you know, we're not interested in that. We're interested in the living room. We're interested in perfect color uniformity. We're interested in big displays, bright displays. You're not part of our strategic plan. And I said, well, that's kind of too bad because we need 100 million units a year. And they said, oh, well, maybe we could become part of your strategic. And that's why scale counts. And that's why we will not launch this without 5 to 10 million units in the first run. And the idea is to launch with enough scale that the scale itself helps bring the price down. And that's why I said 7 to 10 million there. And we're doing it without a sales and marketing team. I mean, you're looking at the sales and marketing team. We will do it by going to 7 large countries and getting them to agree and launch it, and then the others can follow. We have partners. It's not hard to guess Google would be one. The others are all playing to pending. And this has been in the press a great deal. It's the so-called green machine that we introduced with Kofi Annan in November at the World Summit. It was held in Tunisia. Now, once people start looking at this, they say, ah, this is a laptop project. Well, no, it's not a laptop project. It's an education project. And the fun part, and I'm quite focused on it, I tell people, you know, I used to be a light bulb, but now I'm a laser. And I'm just going to get that thing built. And it turns out it's not so hard, because laptop economics are the following. I say 50% here, it's more like 60. 60% of the cost of your laptop is sales, marketing, distribution, and profit. Now, we have none of those, okay? None of those figure into our cost because, first of all, we sell it at cost, and the government's distributed. It gets distributed to the school system like a textbook. So that piece disappears. Then you have display and everything else. Now, the display on your laptop costs, in rough numbers, $10 a diagonal inch. Now, that can drop to 8, can drop to 7, but it's not going to drop to 2 or a 1.5 unless we do some pretty clever things. It's the rest, that little brown box, that is pretty fascinating, because the rest of your laptop is devoted to itself. It's a little bit like an obese person having to use most of their energy to move their obesity, okay? And we have a situation today which is incredible, okay? I've been using laptops since their inception, and my laptop runs slower, less reliably, and less pleasantly than it ever has before. And this year is worse. Now, people clap. Sometimes you even get standing ovations. And I say, what the hell's wrong with you? Why are we all sitting there? And this is and somebody, to remain nameless, called our laptop a gadget recently. And I said, God, our laptop's going to go like a bat out of hell. When you open it up, it's going to go bing, it'll be on, it'll use it, it'll be just like it was in 1985 when you bought an Apple Macintosh 5.12, it worked really well, and we've been going steadily downhill. Now, this people ask all the time what it is, that's what it is. The two pieces that are probably notable is it'll be a mesh network, so when the kids open up their laptops, they all become a network, and then just need one or two points of backhaul. You can serve a couple of thousand kids with 2 megabits. So you really can bring into a village, and then the villages can connect themselves, and you really can do it quite well. The dual mode display, the idea is to have a display that both works outdoors. Isn't it fun using your cell phone outdoors in the sunlight? Well, you can't see it. And one of the reasons you can't see it is because it's backlighting most of the time, the most cell phones. Now, what we're doing is we're doing one that will be both front lit and backlit. And you, whether you manually switch it or you do it in software, is to be seen. But when it's backlit, it's color. When it's front lit, it's black and white at 3 times the resolution. Is it all worked out? No. That's why a lot of our people are more or less living in Taiwan right now. And in about 30 days, we'll know for sure whether this works. It's probably the most important piece there is that the kids really can do the maintenance. And this is, again, something that people, you know, don't believe, but I really think it's quite true. That's the machine we showed. In Tunis, this is more the direction that we're going to go, and it's something that we didn't think was possible. Now, I'm going to pass this around. This isn't a design, okay? So this is just a mechanical engineering sort of embodiment of it for you to play with, and it's clearly just a model. The working one is at MIT, and the ones I'm going to pass it to this handsome gentleman to at least you can decide whether it goes left. Oh, simulcast. Sorry, I forgot.
Just
okay.
Show it off.
So wherever the camera is. Okay, good point. Thank you, Chris. The idea was that it would be not only a laptop, but that it could transform and be into an electronic book. So it's sort of an electronic book. This is where when you go outside, it's in black and white. The games buttons are missing, but it'll be also a games machine, book machine. Set it up this way, and it's a television set, et cetera, et cetera. Is that enough for simulcast?
Thank you.
Sorry. But, I'll let Jim decide which way to send it afterwards. Okay, 7 countries. I say maybe for Massachusetts because they actually have to do a bid. It's by law, you've got a bid and so on and so forth, so I can't quite name them. The other case is they don't have to do bids. They can decide it's the federal government in each case. It's kind of agonizing because a lot of people say, well, let's do it at the state level because, of course, states are more nimble than the feds just because of size. And yet we can't. We're really dealing with the federal government. We're really dealing with ministries of education. And if you look at governments around the world, ministries of education tend to be the most conservative and also the ones that have, you know, huge payrolls. Everybody thinks they know about education. A lot of culture is built into it as well. It's really hard, and so it's certainly the hard road. If you look at the countries, they're pretty geo-culturally distributed. Have they all agreed? No, not completely. Probably Thailand, Brazil, and Nigeria are the three that are the most active and most agreed. We're purposefully not signing anything with anybody until we actually have the working ones. And since I visit each one of those countries within at least every 3 months, I'm just going around the world every 3 weeks. Here's sort of the schedule, and I put at the bottom, we might give some away free in 2 years at this meeting. This is what, when everybody says it's a $100 laptop, you can't do it. Well, guess what, we're not. We're coming in probably at $135 to start, then drift down. And that's very important, because so many things hit the market at a price and then drift up. You know, it's kind of the lost leader, and then as soon as it looks interesting, it can't be afforded or it can't be scaled out. So we're targeting $50 in 2010. The gray market's a big issue, and one of the ways to help in the case of the gray market is to make something that is so utterly unique, it's a little bit like the fact that automobiles, thousands of automobiles are stolen every day in the United States. Not one single post office truck is stolen. Okay. And why? Because there's no market for post office trucks. It looks like a post office truck. You can spray paint it, you can do anything you want. I just learned recently in South Africa, no white Volvos are stolen, period. None, zero. So we want to make it very much like a white Volvo. Each government has a task force. This perhaps is less interesting, but we're trying to get the governments to all work together, and it's not easy. The economics of this is to start with the federal governments and then later to go to other sort of subsequently go to whether it's child-to-child funding, so a child in this country buys one for a child in the developing world, maybe of the same gender, maybe of the same age, or an uncle gives a niece or a nephew that as a birthday present. I mean, there are all sorts of things that will happen, and it'll be very, very exciting. And you know, everybody says, well, it's an education project. Are we providing the software? The answer is, the system certainly has software, but no, we're not providing the education content. That is really done in the countries, but we are certainly constructionists, and we certainly believe in learning by doing, and everything from Logo, which was started in 1968, to more modern things like Scratch, if you've ever even heard of it, are very, very much part of it. And that's the rollout. Are we dreaming? Is this real? It actually is real. The only criticism, and people really don't want to criticize this because it is a humanitarian effort, it is a nonprofit effort, and to criticize it is a little bit stupid, actually. But the one thing that people could criticize was, great idea, but these guys can't do it. And that could either mean these guys, professors and so on, couldn't do it, or that it's not possible. Well, on December 12th, a company called Quanta agreed to build it, and since they make about one-third of all the laptops on the planet today, that question disappeared. So it's not a matter of whether it's going to happen. It is going to happen, and you know, if it comes out at $138, so what? If it comes out 6 months late, so what? That's a pretty soft landing. Thank you.
Thank you.
What if great ideas weren't cherished? What if they carried no importance? Or held no value? There is a place where artistic vision is protected, where inspired design ideas live on to become ultimate driving machines.